Let's get an update now on the weather from PAGASA forecaster Veronica Torres. Good morning, Veronica.
Good morning, Ms. Bettina, and all of our audience. As of now, the northeast monsoon is currently affecting northern and central Luzon. So because of the northeast monsoon, we're expecting cloudy skies with rains over Cagayan Valley, Aurora, Quezon, and Camarines Norte. For Cordillera Administrative Region, we're expecting cloudy skies with light rains. And for Metro Manila, Ilocos Region, the rest of Central Luzon, and the rest of Calabar Zone, we're expecting partly cloudy to cloudy skies with isolated light rains. And for the rest of the country, we're expecting partly cloudy to cloudy skies with isolated rain showers or thunderstorms. Currently, we have a gale warning raised over the seaboard of Northern Luzon and the eastern seaboards of Central and Southern Luzon. So it will be risky for small sea vessels to venture out into the ocean. And as of now, we're not monitoring any low-pressure area or tropical cyclone near or inside the Philippine area of responsibility. And that's the latest from PAGASA Weather Forecasting Center, Veronica C. Torres reporting.
Thank you very much for that update, Veronica. Respiratory diseases still at the top 20 causes of deaths among Filipinos last year. But as Joyce Balancho tells us, two hospitals can now provide aid to those who are in need of help for lung treatments.
The Philippine Statistics Authority or PSA data on July 2023 shows that respiratory illnesses are still among the top 20 causes of deaths in the Philippines. From January to May of last year, pneumonia ranked fifth with 13,462 recorded deaths, while chronic lower respiratory disease and respiratory tuberculosis placed 7th and 9th respectively. The Lung Center of the Philippines, or the LCP, and the National Kidney and Transplant Institute, or the NKTI, say deaths due to respiratory diseases, especially the most severe ones, could have been avoided if proper treatment and surgeries are given appropriately. On Tuesday, the two public specialty hospitals launched the lung transplant program, which aims to provide affordable health care for those with severe lung conditions. While the LCP has long been offering the program, there were challenges that needed the help of the NKTI.
We get the organs from donors, volunteers who are brain dead. And NKTI has put up the human organ procurement effort. Or the HOPE, and this is the organ procurement organization that has this network in different hospitals, and they are the ones who actually provide the donors for us.
Dr. Villaroman says only selected patients are recommended to undergo the program.
Pwede yan dahil sa tinatawag na COPD or emphysema, pwede yan because of nasira ang baga, because of infection like bronchiectasis, or yung mga autoimmune or connective tissue disorders that affects the lung, ito na lang kumbaga yung last resort, no? Hindi naman namin ino-offer ito as a first line ng treatment, no, for advanced lung disease.
Lung transplantation, including all the procedures before and after, would cost around 2.5 to 3 million pesos, depending on the specific needs of the patient. The program offers assistance to those who may not be able to afford the cost of the procedures.
There are sources ng funding na pwede namin kuhanan, no? Including na yan yung sa Malasakit Center, kasama na nga yung MAIF funds, no? And we also utilize the MOE funds na meron kami dito sa Lung Center, natutulungan yung mga pasyente at kanilang ginagastos is very minimal.
Three patients will soon benefit from the program, including 24-year-old Marlene Kiambao.
Meron po akong interstitial lung disease for 12 years and sobrang happy ko po dahil nagkaroon po ng lung transplant program sa Lung Center and isa po ako sa candidate for lung transplant. Sana po soon is magkaroon na po ako ng donor dahil ang kala ko po is magiging life support na po yung oxygen ko.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. is confident that the new project will further improve the public health care.
The partnership between LCP and NKTI can be a template in which hospitals pool the resources and share assets to boost patient care and improve bottom lines. the launch of the LCP and NKTI lung transplant program is an application of the proven maxim that two heads, two hospitals are better than one.
President Marcos also vows to fully rebuild the NKTI Annex building that was destroyed in a fire in 1998.
I was a little sad to hear that the damage that was caused by the fire of 98 has not yet been completely rehabilitated. And I think that's the first thing that we have to look to. So we are playing catch up, but we will do all that we can. In government,
the president also expressed gratitude to the sacrifices of medical workers, especially during the height of the pandemic. He says he hopes to see their continued dedication as they provide health care to Filipinos. Joyce Balancho, ABS-CBN News.
Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. rules out cooperation with an international probe on the Duterte administration's drug war. His categorical remarks followed a challenge from a senator who was once the drug war's chief implementer. Katrina Domingo reports.
A threat to the country's sovereignty. That's how President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. described the International Criminal Court should it continue its investigations on former President Rodrigo Duterte's war on drugs. Marcos Jr. insists his administration will not cooperate with the ICC's investigation as the international tribunal no longer has jurisdiction over the Philippines.
Let me say this for the 100th time. I do not recognize the jurisdiction of ICC in the Philippines. I consider it as a threat to our sovereignty. Therefore, the Philippine government will not lift a finger to help any investigation that the ICC conducts.
The issue over the ICC and its investigation into Duterte's drug war simmered anew this month after speculation that foreign investigators are already in the country to begin looking into the cases of alleged extrajudicial killings and human rights abuses during Duterte's crackdown on illegal drug peddlers, an allegation which the Department of Justice denied.
Wala itong natatanggap na opisyal na komunikasyon o kumpirmasyon na nasa loob na ng bansa ang mga kinatawa ng ICC.
The Philippines withdrew from the ICC in 2019 after a petition to look into the Philippines' human rights situation under the Duterte administration was filed before the international body. Last year, President Marcos Jr. said the Philippines is studying the possibility of rejoining the ICC. But he clarifies that while ICC investigators may enter the Philippines on a personal capacity, his administration will not aid them in their investigations.
In fact, binabantayan namin sila, making sure that they do not come into contact with any agency of government. And if they are contacting agencies of government, na sasabihin yung whatever, policeman, local government, sabihin nyo, wag nyong sasagutin. Yun ang sagot natin, that we do not recognize your jurisdiction, therefore we will not assist in any way, shape, or form any of the investigations that the ICC is doing here in the Philippines.
Marcos Jr.'s remarks come a day after Senator Ronald De La Rosa urged him to be upfront on whether or not ICC investigators are in the country to serve his arrest warrant. De La Rosa, Duterte's former chief of police, is considered as the implementer of the war on drugs that killed thousands of suspected drug peddlers and users, including minors.
Maghintay na lang tayo. Anong next na development dyan? Kung maglabas sila ng warrant of arrest, then mag-cooperate yung government natin, ipa-resto kami, then andito lang ako. Hindi ako pwede magtago dahil kaya saan ako magtago? Yung ulo ko, hindi ko ito may tatago. Kilala itong ulo ko.
Former President Duterte has yet to issue fresh statements about the ICC and the possible presence of its investigators in the Philippines. But his daughter, Vice President Sara Duterte, released a statement denying involvement with the so-called Davao Death Squad. The Vice President says she is surprised to learn that she is now among the accused before the ICC, adding she does not need a death squad for things she can accomplish herself. The Vice President also says she is ready to face the accusations before a Filipino judge and only before a Filipino court. Katrina Domingo, ABS-CBN News.
Turning now to the growing divide between the two chambers of the Philippine Congress. In a bold move, all 24 senators signed a manifesto Tuesday, firmly rejecting the People's Initiative to amend the 1987 Constitution. They called the ongoing campaign a sinister attempt that will exploit the country's democratic process.
It is ridiculous that the Senate, as a co-equal chamber of the House, which is needed to pass even local bills, will have a dispensable and diluted role in charter change, the most monumental act of policymaking concerning the highest law of the land. This so-called People's Initiative proposes only one change. In acting as a constituent assembly, the Senate and the House shall vote jointly. While it seems simple, my dear friends, the goal is apparent: to make it easier to revise the Constitution by eliminating the Senate from the equation.
The lower house revived the push to amend the Constitution late last year. It has since been gaining ground, but not without controversy, including an alleged signature buying campaign to support the People's Initiative. The senators lashing out at House lawmakers who are supposedly leading the campaign.
That's my worry. If the both houses do not agree and we have a constitutional crisis, talaga magkakaroon tayo ng ano rito, ng deadlock. No? Baka wala mapas na bills. It will definitely affect the process of lawmaking, yung budget. So, I don't know. That's why I'm hoping that we have both houses have to honor what has been agreed upon.
Sa mga akala kong kaibigan ko, solian na ho tayo ng kandila.
Despite the backlash from the Senate, the House of Representatives reiterates its commitment to the People's Initiative. House Speaker Martin Romualdez says the chamber is ready to provide a transparent and accountable framework to support the People's Initiative, which he calls the purest form of democracy. Despite his support, Romualdez denies any hand in the ongoing signature drive. Some senators earlier accused Romualdez and other House lawmakers of being behind the bribery scheme. Vice President Sara Duterte announces her intent to run in the country's next election, but she did not specify which position she will run for and whether it would be in 2025 or 2028. She also notes it is her personal decision to seek another post.
Kinabuhi, no? Ugang politika, parinora na sila. Wala takibalo kung unsay mahitabo. Ugma. So, open ng tanan. Especially karon nga naay maabot na election sa 2025 and sa 2028.
The Philippine poll body meanwhile notes possible scenarios if Duterte pushes through with her plan. Duterte's term ends in 2028 and only Senate, congressional, and local seats will be up for voting next year.
If an official, elective official presently elected and serving will run to a position higher or lower than the position that he is presently holding, and if he or she will lose the election, then he will go back to the present position that he has presently without losing the same, simply because the term had not yet ended or had not yet expired.
And if she wins?
Then it's up to him or her to choose which position of the two will she or he will choose. Under the Constitution, it's the president who will be choosing, coming from the member, a member of the Senate or the House of Representatives.